not advancing by itself, so I will have to manually advance it.
Ellen Rothenberg.
Okay, so this morning is almost exactly 13 weeks from the night that Eric died, between 2 and 3 in the morning. And for those of us who knew him well and were close to him, this has been a very large change in the world. But I'm going to try to concentrate now on some of the aspects of his science and his personality as it informed his science, because I think that this is really his most interesting and to the widest number of people. So Eric was a very vital person, and the pictures that I'm showing you are some pictures mostly from myself from the 1990s, the one that was from Sports Illustrated, August 31st, 1987, in an article about this Caltech sports team. You can see Eric and Mike Levine on a fossil hunting trip. Mike and Andy McMahon, who created the gene transfer system for the sea urchin embryo at Eric's 70th birthday party, and some other pictures from 1994 in the other slides. Eric loved molecular biology. He also loved development. He loved the logic and the richness of developmental processes. And he loved history. He loved history of human societies. He loved archaeology. He loved geology. He loved the history of science. All of these are data-rich fields, but they're fields with underlying structures and underlying causality explanations in them, and that's what Eric loved about them. And he also contributed greatly to our insights at the intersections of these fields, like the way molecular biology informs development and the history of thought and development in molecular biology. He was very important as a theorist. His lab basically created the sea urchin as a gene regulatory model system. He was a visionary. I think anyone who's really read a lot of his theoretical work can see how far ahead of the curve he was in most of the work that he did. And he was an unforgettable colleague and friend. And I think that the qualities that gave him the ability to do these things was, and become these things, is that he had great gifts, powers of intense concentration, and at the same time, selective but very, very broad curiosity. He was an extremely warm person. He was an inspirational person. He was a difficult person. I think we all agree about that. He had three big influences that shaped his work. And the juxtaposition of these influences was very unusual. Just in order of when he encountered them, to some extent, classical embryology. I think by 1986, he probably knew more classical embryology in detail than almost anyone left in molecular biology. Certainly by 2015, he knew more classical embryology than almost anyone left alive. Biophysics, he loved biophysics, which he shared with Roy Britton and made a very large part of his research program. And he had a very complicated legacy from his father, which also really influenced his personality in many, many ways and influenced his work. The depth of his engagement with what you could call archaic descriptive embryology was really, really unique. But part of it was not just a question of collecting knowledge. A lot of it was that he deeply respected some of the turn of the last century biologists, including, for example, Theodore Boveri and E.B. Wilson, for their ability to reason about underlying mechanism, despite the fact that at their time they had very, very limited experimental tools. The depth with which they could perceive things and draw conclusions which stood the test of time from very, very limited data. And he loved and admired physicists because he loved the purity of the thought, the logic, and the quantitative rigor of physics. And he also really liked the uncompromising intellectual style, which is so much characteristic of physicists. He would just come back braced with joy after having sort of locked horns with physicists. And his father was related to this, actually, even though he had nothing to do with physics. His father was a tough, irascible professional artist who loved Eric, but it was tough love, and he first taught Eric how to defend himself with his fists. And by the time Eric was a teenager, they had epic battles, apparently. And yet, the exposure that Eric had to his father's art, the continuing discussion of art theory, and the love and respect that lay underneath all the conflict, really resonated with him throughout his life, and he constantly cited the love of abstract composition and a love for the beauty and complexity that he got from his father. So I think many, many people will speak or have spoken about the remarkable close circle of Eric's career, to the extent that the theoretical work that he did in 1968 with Roy Britton, building a model of gene networks for differential gene expression in different cell types, looked remarkably like a prototype for exactly what he was publishing in 2012 and later, gene regulatory network models in which multiple inputs impinged upon multiple targets in various combinatorial ways, and in which the logic of regulation was integral to the developmental process. And when he would talk about this at the end, especially in sort of like the summing up work that he would write with Isabel Peter, you could almost think that he just flew through the air from 1968 to 2012 without ever touching the ground. But that actually wasn't, and as though pure logic had done everything in between, but that really wasn't true. And one of the reasons I'm bringing in these pictures from the 1990s is that I would argue that the 80s and 90s were, the 80s were a pivotal decade in which he changed direction in a major way. The 90s were an incredibly fertile, formative decade in which many of the themes that really made an impact on the field afterwards were born in his lab. And there are many influences of many people on this, and I'm hoping I'll have a chance in another place to write about this in more detail. But these early years were very important, and they were grounded. So even though there was these big maps of the theories, there's actual terrain underneath, and he had been actually at work with his pickaxe, you know, carving a path through that terrain to extend the metaphor. His lab, for decades, pushed forward detailed experimental knowledge of the sea urchin system, basically kind of creating it as a framework for doing molecular biology. And these relentless studies of measurements and exploratory work at the forefront of molecular biology. When he gave presentations, he emphasizes his current views of the take-home lessons of his work as though they were engraved in stone. And I think a lot of people were deceived by this, but in his actual lab, in his actual life, and in his interactions with the people in his lab, he was constantly refining and testing, correcting and reconstructing the pictures of the regulatory systems he studied, and he never considered it finished work. In fact, this gave a kind of a poignancy to these statements at the end of the Boolean model paper that this was almost complete, because he had been doing models for 10 years. Everyone was different from the next. Every one of them had corrections from the previous one. And only now was he beginning to feel that he almost could account for everything that he knew about the system. He was also a technological innovator too, although many people didn't really credit him with this. He preferred to publish in his favorite journals, which were PNAS and Developmental Biology, and earlier than that, Development, rather than Cell and Nature. And as a result, he was completely able to avoid being given credit for things that he invented years before other people did and implemented in his lab. And so, you know, nobody cites Zheng and Nam for the barcoding of enhancers for high-throughput functional assays, but that was published a good bit before Alexander Stark and all of the other fancy people who are cited for this ad nauseum. So he was very interested. He was not at all afraid of breaking the ground technologically. But I think the technology was always a handmaiden to what his real goal was. He really believed that the point of doing science is essentially and fundamentally intellectual in the highest sense. That is what we should be doing this for. The whole point of doing any experiments has to be to resolve some deeper mechanism involved in the thing that he wanted to understand more than anything else, which is how nature works. And he used that phrase repeatedly with the highest as the highest goal. And therefore, for him, the corollary was that a scientist has to take responsibility at each stage in his or her work for defining and exploring the implications, the results that he or she has gotten, and determining how that should impact our knowledge of the wider field. And his view was that this imperative can't wait. You can't wait till you know everything about the system and you know it in complete detail. it suddenly he thought that you had to do every single step of the process, despite the fact that that would mean that some of the results on which your interim theories were based were going to have to be corrected later. He thought that was part of the process, also part of the absolute obligation of a scientist as an intellectual. And so the interlacing of experiment with theory was continuous in his life, and it's a reason why the theory really did continuously change, even though that's not always clear in hindsight at the retrospectives. So he was a larger-than-life personality, as many of us encountered, either in small doses or in large doses. He had boundless energy and great charm, as well as a tendency to bulldoze his way through to what he wanted. In the 1980s, when I arrived at Caltech, he was running a lab of about 30 people. He was working at the frontier of molecular biology, as well as laying the groundwork for sea urchin gene transfer. That's Andy McMahon right there, Costas Flitsanis, Roberta Franks, Barbara Hoff Evans, many people, Frank Castle, many people played a huge role in this. Andy Cameron, Andy Ranza came in to start cell lineage tracing in sea urchin and cis regulatory sequence cloning, which became a big part of the lab. But at this very same time, he was player manager on a city league touch football team that included ex-NFL players. And he was also a reserve linebacker on the Caltech football team, where he actually lettered 4 years between ages 46 and 49. And the Caltech football team was a little bit odd, which is why Sports Illustrated ran an article about it as sort of a human interest piece, but nevertheless. Also, he regularly played banjo in a well-regarded traditional Appalachian music group, which concertized all over Southern California and recorded 6 albums. In the 1990s, while this group was creating important paradigms in how cis-regulatory elements work and really defining a sort of departure from inspiration from Mike Levine, he basically started to argue formally about how cis-regulatory elements act as little computers. He was still continuing to play football, and he was still playing band concerts until he was in his 70s. He had great physical vitality, and there's a sense that everything was urgent, and these qualities spilled over into everything he did, including the many things he did that were extremely generous and supportive of people around him. The dark side with this hurry, 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 hurry mode that he was in was that he had a serious weakness in being able to listen carefully to what others were saying, and he was negligent about trying to persuade rather than to pronounce, and I think that this had a number of consequences for his career and for his impact on the field, which are unfortunate, even though they were prices he paid for being able to do what he did. He felt he had no time to stop for anything, including to really listen to what someone else was saying. But the ability to be strong and capable, be an athlete, be a musician, created a huge circle of friends for him from all walks of life, way outside of science and academia. And these are friends that were loyal to him till the day of his death, and they were among the most moving speakers at his funeral. His physical vitality was his armor for more than half a century. And what this meant was that it was quite a considerable challenge when things changed starting in 2003, and then particularly in the last 4 years when he became progressively crippled with a very bad spinal stenosis, to the point that he lost the ability to walk about 2 years ago. He couldn't stand 1 year ago. By the summer, he couldn't even lift himself from a chair. And it was under these conditions that it became clear that under all of this physical swashbuckling, he had real courage, and the courage to stay mentally strong and creative and game, even when everything else in his life had been taken away. So the last thing I just want to say is that his intellectual life was extremely rich. He was voraciously engaged with full explanations, whatever the subject was. Voracious for depth and the detail of the subjects themselves, and always wanted to seek into their causal origins. So he loved reading history, and best history if it was written by scholars who drew from well-referenced primary sources. You couldn't give him a Christmas present of a book that didn't have footnotes. He would just immediately give it away. His wide knowledge created a matrix over the decades in which every new piece of information got crystallized, a whole set of new connections with what he already knew. He was endlessly interested in finding logic rules that could organize and harmonize complexity. and he never preferred a simplified view of anything. What he really loved was the clarity of relationships that actually explained complex structures. That was what was the most beautiful thing to him. And he was an extraordinary person to talk with, argue with, and to have as a friend. And those of us who were lucky to know him well found our own ideas much enhanced by give and take with him. And he made our sense of the possible expand greatly. And he enriched our lives a great deal by the time we were allotted to spend with him. So I remember him with the deepest gratitude. And I think that's all I have to say.